be no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Y'all sing with us and put your hands together this morning. Just like a blind man, I wandered along. Worries and fears I claimed for my own. Then like the blind man, that God gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in the night. So happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I was a fool to wander and stray. Straight is the gate and narrow the way. Now I have traded the wrong for the right. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Well, I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in the night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Well, praise the Lord, I saw the light.
Good morning, everybody. Man, how is everybody doing? Good? All right. Well, we just got a few announcements, and, here we go. we will have barrels and Bibles tomorrow, 6:30 p.m., so come on out. And also, Veterans Day is coming up, so we want to honor and recognize our veterans this Sunday, and we're going to have Jim as well come and honor them. But if you're a veteran, would you please stand at this time? We'd love to honor you at this time. Come on over, Jim.
Thank you, guys and ladies. I didn't see any ladies, but I saw some guys. Do you realize that less than 2% of the population of the United States of America serve in the military? Think about that, less than 2%. These gentlemen that stood up in front of you a while ago or stood here for a minute, once upon a time in their life, they took an oath that started off, I do solemnly swear to defend and support, to defend the Constitution of the United States of America against all enemies, both foreign and domestic. It goes on to talk about how they will be faithful to those opponent over them and other things. But just remember that there's only two defining spirits that ever promised to die for you. Jesus Christ and the American GI. One died for your soul, the other died for your freedom. Think about that come Wednesday.
Amen. If you're children, you haven't gone back. If you're a Wrangler, you can head on to the back and go enjoy the service. If you have infant, any level, any age at all, you can head on back and all the way back there. There you go. Well, let's pray and let's join back into worship. Father, we thank you so much for this morning. We thank you for this time. Lord, we thank you for such a great opportunity to live where we need to trust you. Every day of our life, no matter the circumstance, no matter what's going on around us, we get to wake up and trust you. We get to rely upon who you are, draw strength from you, draw courage from you, draw hope from you and faith and whatever we need in that moment. And Lord, I thank you that in the uncertainty of life and the uncertainty of direction, you can bring peace. And that's what we need the most. Walk in your peace, trusting in your peace, and knowing that you love us and that you have things planned. So would you open up our hearts today? Would you open up our minds today that we would just see you in a way that we would draw unto you and rest in you? In Jesus' name, amen.
just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time. Dwelling place, O Lord Almighty, for my soul longs and even faints for you. And here my heart is satisfied within your presence. I sing beneath the shadow of your wings. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. One thing I ask and I would see. To see your beauty, to find you in. the place your glory dwells. Yes, one thing I ask, and I would seek to see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Thousands elsewhere. Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to just as I am, and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blood, to thee whose blood can cleanse each spot. Just as I am, though tossed about with many a conflict, many a doubt, fightings and fears within, without, O Lamb of God, just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve, because thy promise I believe, O Lamb of God, I come. past the outer courts into the holy place, past the brazen altar, Lord, I want to see your face. Pass me by the crowds of people, the priests who sing your praise. I hunger and thirst for your righteousness, but it's only found in one place. Take me in to the Holy of Holies. Take me in by the blood of the Lamb. Take me in to the Holy of Holies. Take the coal, touch my lips, here I am. Take me past the outer courts and to the holy place, past the brazen altar, Lord, I want to see your face. Pass me by the crowds of people, the priests who sing your praise. I hunger and thirst for your righteousness, but it's only found in one place. Take me in to the holy holies. Take me in by the blood of the Lamb. Take me in to the holy of holies. Take the coal, touch my lips, here I am. Take me in to the Holy of Holies. Take me in by the blood of the Lamb. Take me in to the Holy of Holies. Take the coal, touch my lips, here I am. Take the coal, touch my lips. Touch my lips, here I am. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary.
Ask you to stand with us as we sing Sanctuary.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be. Sanctuary.
Father, it's good to be here. Father, it's good to be in this place with these people. For truly, this place is not special in as much as you're not anywhere else. But it's this place where we meet to worship you. And it's these people, it's family, it's the kingdom of God that comes together and as one body. And Father, with one heart, we worship the one true God. Holy Spirit, continue with us. And as we open your word, we ask that you would speak. Speak afresh, speak anew. And Father, we pray this morning that we will have the eyes to see, the ears to hear you, our Lord and our God. Father, I pray that I will decrease, that you will increase. In Jesus' name, amen. Good morning. As I said, it's been kind of an odd few weeks putting together sermons. I feel that God was leading me to the Beatitudes. It's not where I wanted to go. That was not what I had planned. But he kept leading me back here, and I desired to share with you a little bit of my journey, a little bit of what I went through during my time off. And these are just precious gems along the way of my path. This morning, I want to speak to you about mourning, about what happens when we hurt, what happens when we experience disappointment and loss. Unfortunately, mourning is common to every single person. If you've taken breath on this earth, you're going to experience some of the things that are going to bring you to a state of mourning. Now, mourning is probably one of the most uncomfortable places to be, but yet with God, it's one of the most necessary places for us to experience. Mourning is that absolute feel of lack of control. Lack of control. I've always said, and I still contend, that control is an illusion, but it's an illusion that we love. It's an illusion. It's a feeling that we really do like. We like to be in control. And when we are mourning, there is no control. We're recognizing that we don't have that. Now, sometimes mourning expresses itself with different emotions. If you've been through mourning, have you ever been angry? Absolutely. You know, you encounter that person at the store, and you come away thinking, man, that's just an angry old man. Maybe he is mourning. Anger, grief, remorse, all of these ideas. This concept that hope is just outside your reach. I want to share with you a passage in Psalm 55. Psalm 55, it is a psalm of David. Beginning in verse 4, this isn't where we're going to be for the text, but I want to share this with you. He said, my heart is in anguish within me. Terrors of death assail me. Fear and trembling have beset me. Horror has overwhelmed me. I said, oh, that I had the wings of a dove. I would fly away and be at rest. I would flee far and stay in the desert. I would hurry to my place of shelter far from the tempest and the storm. Okay, do you get what David is saying? He says, I want to run away and hide. That's literally what he's saying. I want to run away and hide. If you've experienced much grief, you understand what David's saying. He does want to run away and hide. But when he recognizes some very important truths that are within him, and down in verse 16, he said, "But I call to God, and the Lord saves me." Now that's future tense. That's future tense. Verse 22, "Cast your cares on the Lord, and He will sustain you. He will never let the righteous fall." Okay, so we've moved from this feeling of, I want to run away, I want to disappear, I don't want to talk to anybody, I don't want to see anybody, to, okay, I know that the God can do something, and now he's at this point of, yes, God is here in the present. You know, when we look for answers in mourning, we don't need to look to the north or the south or the east or the west. Folks, we need to look up. We need to look up to God. You know, this idea of mourning, it has beset humanity from the very beginning of time. When man began to really write and philosophize, we've got many ancient texts about mourning. They deal with how long is appropriate to mourn. They deal with what you should do when you mourn. They even deal with what you should wear when you mourn. Whether it was the Stoics or the Sophist or Plato, they're trying to wrestle with this idea of mourning, of hurting. So many times we go back to this idea of retributive justice. We come back, and that, you remember, when we went through the book of Job. The book of Job is dealing with this idea of retributive justice. Retributive justice simply says, you do good, you get good. You do bad, you get bad. Job had not done bad, but he did not get good. It works a lot of times, but it's not all the time. People are mourning, people are hurting, well, they just need to get themselves up out of it. No, mourning is a necessary thing. Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 31. "But those who hope in the Lord," y'all know this one, "but those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint." In other words, where do we get this strength, this gumption to get up and to move forward? From God. It is from God. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 4. This is the second of the Beatitudes. It's going to begin with this same formula. Blessed are. Remember, it's not that you're giddy because everything's great around you. It's that you're blissful. You have joy within you despite what's going on around you. You have that within you because of God. He says, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." May God bless the reading of His Word. This true happiness comes through sorrow. Now, what do we mourn? I want to suggest to you this morning three things that are worthy that we mourn. Number one is just human sorrow. Human sorrow. When someone dies, when they take that short step of death, hopefully into heaven. But we mourn, don't we? Especially if they're close to us. We really mourn and we hurt. If it was a spouse or a child or even a parent, we are going to mourn when they pass. You know, I don't keep up with exact numbers of things on purpose. I'm not a numbers person because I don't want to focus on those numbers. The number of funerals that I've done is somewhere around, I have approximations, around 2,700. Around 2,700 funerals. And it really, it doesn't matter how close I know them or how much I don't know them, I still have to do this same thing. I have to put up a wall. And the wall, it can't go all the way up, because if I block all emotions and I don't feel anything that the family feels, I'm pretty ineffective. But if that wall is too low and I am feeling too much of that hurt, I can't be very effective either. I have to really be careful about my wall, because there's times that I do funerals and I really do hurt. I really do hurt. My mother's funeral, I wasn't going to let somebody else do it. I needed to do it. But you know what? I really did hurt. I really did. We mourn when disappointments, when we don't achieve something or we fall short on something. That's okay. It's okay to mourn that. But you know, there is a positive side, because there is something to learn from mourning. In fact, there's a lot to learn from mourning. It teaches us to be appreciative. It teaches us to be appreciative. Have you ever experienced a loss and you're mourning it and you're like, boy, you know, I should have spent more time with them. Doesn't have anything to do with how much money or anything else. Time. Quality time. And it increases our sensitivity to others. Once we've experienced these losses, this devastation, and we mourn, we are a little more sympathetic with others who mourn. We can mourn the evil that's in this world. The evil that's in this world. There is a lot of evil in this world. This is a sin-fallen world. There's a lot of trash, a lot of horrible that goes on in this world. And we do need to mourn that. We need to mourn things like abortion. We need to mourn things like slavery. Do you realize that still goes on today? We need to mourn things like human sex trafficking. We need to mourn the evils and the wrongs, just what we would call the little things, when people lie, cheat, and steal. We need to mourn these things that affect us and affect our children and our grandchildren. It tells us we do need to be involved in our social arena. We need to have a voice. We don't need to just stand by and not say anything and look down at the ground. We need to be involved. But what we need to be involved in needs to have a goal. It needs to have a goal. And that goal is reconciliation to God. Reconciling a lost world, sinners, to a holy God. Because when we mourn, we have the absolute that God Himself will act. Do you realize that? God Himself will act. One of my favorite passages, it's on my wall in my office. It's been there for years and years, and it was in previous offices before I came here, is Isaiah 61. Because Isaiah 61, it's a messianic passage. It's talking about what the Messiah is going to do when He comes. But it's also what I should be imitating Him in doing. Isaiah 61 reads, "The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, listen to this, to comfort all who mourn. That's what our God does. That's what Jesus does. And if I am going to be a follower, a disciple, a servant, I'm going to be doing the same thing. I'm going to be coming alongside those who are mourning, those who are hurting. I want you to get this. Blessed are those who mourn. I love this one commentator that I read for the word that's translated for. He said, you know, what would happen if we translated it because? I kind of like that. Blessed are those who mourn because they will be comforted. I want you to notice something. That's in the present tense. That's in the present tense. It's not something that is way off. It's not something that we can't have right now. That comforting is right now. You've heard me say it before. The valleys are so necessary in our lives because we learn things about God and we experience things of God in the valleys that we would not experience on the mountaintops. Those valleys are absolutely necessary. Why? Because it's in the valleys that God teaches and God transforms us into the people He wants us to be to serve Him. Those valleys can be long and deep, but they're necessary. Without those valleys, you will not be the person God has for you to be. So many times, you know, we give our resume when we tell people about ourselves, and we want to tell about our accomplishments. Well, yeah, I did this, and I did this, and I won this, and yeah, that's great. But you want to know who a person really is? Go to their valleys. Go to the places where they mourn. That's where God makes the godly person. I want to tell you about a lady named Mary. This is a true story. Unbelievable, but true. Mary was at work. Her father had been in bad health. She got a call, and the call was, you need to get here as quick as you can. Your father does not have much time. Well, there was a problem. He lived on the other side of the country. She left her office immediately, did not go by the house and pack a bag. She went immediately to the airport. She booked a flight and was on standby. And for 5 hours, she waited on a flight to be going toward where her dad was, where he is dying. She got on the airplane. As she went to put her phone on airplane mode, it rang. She got the call. Her father had passed. Well, she sat quietly, just in shock, and she made the flight. She came off the airplane, and in the where she deboarded, she just found a chair, and she sat down. Her legs would not hold her up. And she began crying. And as she tells the story, she said, I'm not a pretty crier. She said, I'm loud. It sounds horrible. She said, but I stayed there and I could do nothing but weep and wail. This was a major airport. She sat there, true story, 2 hours. It wasn't just the people at that gate. All through the airport, they could hear her weeping. And in an airport, some 3,000 people in it. in 2 hours, not one person, not one person came alongside her. Valleys. Those places that we don't like because it's uncomfortable. Those places that we don't like because we can't control. Those places that we don't like because we hurt. But those places that are necessary in every single life. But because there are valleys. Because there are valleys. Charity, could we have that video? I wish I could take away people's pain and hurt. I would if I could. But it's not for me to take away pain. It's for me to come alongside, to give love, to give support, and to focus people on God. Mourning is hard, but it makes you who you truly are. There are those this morning right here, right now, that are mourning. I want to say I love you, I'll hurt with you, and God is our answer. There are those of you this morning that can come alongside somebody, and it's not the words that you speak. It's the presence that you give because you care. Those deep, hard valleys. I praise God for them. Father, thank you for being you, for being our God. And Father, for each one in here this morning that's mourning, God, I speak blessing over them, the blessing of your presence, the blessing of your voice speaking into their lives and into their hearts. And I ask God, give me opportunity to come alongside. God, we love you and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. May God bless you.